Welcome to the Fabulous 413. I'm Monty Belmonte. Khalees Smith is still away. But later in the show, Memorex Khalees Smith and I will pit two Mediterranean wines against each other in the Wine Thunderdome at Table and Vine, along with Table and Vine ambassador Michael Quinlan. It's Friday, which means it's Live Music Friday, and later we'll hear live music from rapper, podcaster, and graphic novelist Tem Blessed, who's playing the Drake in Amherst tonight. It'll be our first live hip-hop on Live Music Friday, which I'm excited about. We've also got something special for Swifties on the way. But earlier today, I was honored to moderate a panel at Smith College for an organization called Massachusetts Farm and Sea to School. Monday on the show, we'll hear from the inspirational panelists who I was thrilled to talk with on stage. But panelists and conference goers alike were surprised when Lieutenant Governor Kim Driscoll spoke to open the conference this morning.
I just want to bring greetings from both myself and Governor Healy. We're so proud and grateful to be part of the first all-female team leading the corner office here in Massachusetts. Today, we're grateful to have such terrific legislative partners here in Representative Lindsay Sabadosa, Senator Joe Comerford. There's a female theme going on out here, and we like it. So, first of all, I just want to say the importance of the work that Mass Farm to School does. You know, for the last 20 years, I think of you as the infrastructure that makes it possible for us in local communities to make those important connections between youth, between school and food nutrition programs, and between farmers and fishermen. This is the type of opportunity that without that infrastructure, we don't really grow, we don't have a full room, we don't have 20 years of conferences, folks are trying to go it alone. I think the opportunity to have sort of the Swiss Army knife approach to ensuring we have the resources and support we need, and all of you learning from each other, bettering your practices, is what makes our school and food nutrition opportunities so terrific. You know, one of the hangovers from the pandemic was we obviously all saw the value of being able to shop local, buy local, and certainly produce local food. Many of our schools certainly have benefited from that, and we see an opportunity for this to grow and flourish as we move forward. Some of the programming that was put in place during the pandemic, like Universal Schools, Massachusetts, now the eighth state to have free breakfast and lunch in all of our public schools, our food security infrastructure grants, or FSIG grants, some of you may have benefited from those as well. These were efforts that started with federal funding to try and stand up and support in the important work we're doing with regard to providing food and addressing food insecurity and supporting infrastructure in the whole line of food processing, from farmers to how food ends up on our tables. As a state, we have committed to ensuring those efforts move forward with now, instead of using federal funds, utilizing state dollars to support those programs. That's helping our agricultural community, that's helping our school and food nutrition efforts, and it's certainly building stronger communities.
That's Lieutenant Governor Kim Driscoll, who surprised everyone today at the Massachusetts Farm and Sea to School Conference that happened at Smith College that I was a part of. On Monday's show, you'll hear from the panelists who were part of that event at Smith College. Irene Shang Lee, who co-founded Food Justice, who co-founded a food justice and advocacy group out of a restaurant called May May Dumplings in Boston. Chevalier Olivier, the executive director of the Mattapan Food and Fitness Coalition, was part of that panel, as well as East Hampton's own Ollie Perrault, a 17-year-old climate activist and farmer who is the director of the Youth Climate Action Now and a founding member of Maura Healey's Advisory Youth Climate Council. That is Monday's show, but right now. 'Cause baby, now we got bad blood. You know it used to be mad love. So take a look what you've done. 'Cause baby, now we got bad blood. Hey! Now we got Jenny Powers is the director of science at the Springfield Museums and, I'm told, is the museum's official Swiftie. And you're here to talk about the new planetarium show, Taylor's Version.
That's right, I am. And I'm not the only Swiftie at Springfield Museum.
Okay.
I'm just one of a few.
Yeah.
And really, who I'm the biggest fan of is my son. And he's the one who introduced me to Taylor Swift's music. He fell in love with her music when he was about six, and he heard it at camp. And so we've been following Taylor ever since.
How old is your son now?
Actually, he's turning 21 on Sunday.
Wow, so that's a lifelong love of Taylor Swift.
Yes.
You went to see Taylor twice on this last tour?
Yes, I sure did. So I went on a Sunday and then the following Saturday. So I went to Gillette and then I went to New Jersey and went to MetLife.
Wow. Were you in the rain at Gillette?
Was that missed the rain show, thank goodness.
My two oldest children were at that particular show. It was legendary for them to be there. What turned into a legendary show, yeah. Although it did ruin my son Enzo's phone.
Yeah, and I believe it ruined Taylor's piano, too.
I'm sure the piano costs a lot more than the phone. But we're talking about Taylor Swift with Jenny Powers, the director of science at the Springfield Museums, because you have something very special happening for Swifties at the planetarium that starts tomorrow. Do tell.
We actually have a few things Taylor related. So tomorrow, the first thing that's happening is this is our first Swiftie Saturday. And so what we've done is we've chosen one album to feature, and we decided to go with her best-selling album, which is 1989 Taylor's Version. Of course, real Swifties only play Taylor's Version.
That's right. And for those who don't understand the Taylor's Version thing, do you very briefly want to describe that? Are you that much of a Swiftie that you can explain
it? Yes, I can describe that briefly. So what happened was she recorded all her masters as a very young person, but she did not own the rights to them. And they got kind of sold out from under her, against her wishes, to somebody who's really not a very nice person. And so rather than let them continue to collect on her hard work, she decided to re-record her catalog. And so that's why we have doubles of so many albums. But in my house, we only listen to Taylor's Version.
That's, I think, a lot of the Swifties do that. Now, our very own NEPM's Nirvani Williams came and experienced some of this 1989 Taylor's Version in the planetarium. So we have a little clip of Nirvani Williams.
Oh my God, you're wearing an Eras shirt.
I am.
Awesome. Okay. Why don't we show you part of the show? So we recommend sitting down because it does get really dark in here and people often stumble around, including me. Still recovering from my last astronomy-related injury. So, but have a seat. Zeiss velvet projectors. Those are what we added last year. And then what you're going to see next is on our Quercus projector, which is the one that's been here since 1937. And this is actually the oldest planetarium projector in the Western Hemisphere. So that's the one right in the middle of the room. It was made for this museum specifically. And at that time, the only other people making planetarium projectors were the Zeiss Corporation. So Springfield, during the Great Depression, couldn't afford one of those. So this was created, but it stands just as high as all the Zeiss projectors it made at that time. But let's talk about Taylor Swift, because I'll talk about the planetarium all day.
Did you talk about Taylor Swift the rest of the time?
Mostly. Yeah.
And
mostly.
It seems like you love equally to talk about both those things. And we will talk about both of those things in just a little bit. But where did this idea come from to make a planetarium show based on the music of Taylor Swift, specifically this one album?
So this isn't actually the first music show that we've done. The first one we did was Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon. We actually didn't even have our new full dome production system yet. But we just saw that it was the 50th anniversary of that album. We got really excited and we thought...
Can I pause right there and say, does it anger you that there's no actual dark side of the moon? That there is just a side of the moon that we don't see from the Earth?
You know, calling it the dark side of the moon is a way to help people understanding, even if it's not actually literally true. You know, we do that sometimes. We take concepts in math that then... You know, when you learn addition, you have to learn it. And then all of a sudden, your professor turns around and changes all the rules on you. And so I would say that's kind of how Dark Side of the Moon is, too. But we did Dark Side of the Moon. We did last year during Pride Month, we did Lady Gaga Born This Way. For Valentine's Day, we did a mixed show with everything from Bon Jovi to Marvin Gaye. So this is actually the newest music show. And we picked Taylor because she is the most popular artist in our entire world right now.
I thought you were going to say orbit for a second there.
Oh, I almost said solar system.
Okay.
But she's the most, she is epic. This is the number one artist that people request for us to do a show. So we said, okay, this is going to be amazing. We should do it. And what we decided to do was do an Eras show where we play one song from every album. And then, of course, with the new album coming out, we'll add that too.
Uh-huh.
And we set those dates for May. People started signing up for those shows as soon as they went live. People were calling me and saying, I'm like, it's February. Why are people calling me about May? And so that just was showing to be such a popular thing, we decided we need to expand this past the two nights that that's happening. That's May 9th and 10th. We're still doing Eras that night. But the rest of the time, we're doing a show that's a little bit shorter. It's not that epic. It's not going to have all the hands-on activities with it. Like, if you come to the Eras show, we'll be making friendship bracelets, of course.
Oh, of course. Big in the Swiftie community.
Yes, exactly. We'll be doing science, too. I want you to do science when you come to the Science Museum. but for this one, because we wanted to make it something that we could sustain doing on a weekly basis, we decided let's pick one album, let's pick the album, and then let's go with it. And I'm really happy with what we picked because it has that perfect, well, you know about this way more than I do, I think, where you want to give people kind of an emotional ride with the music. And so with 1989, it's easy to give people an emotional ride. I think without giving away too much, I can say the last song is Shake It Off.
Okay, that's great. And this was created for the Springfield Museums by one of the folks that works with the planetarium, right?
Yes. His name is Nathan Wood. He is a phenomenal person. So he just got promoted last year. Now he's our planetarium coordinator. I see many more great things in his future. He is a fantastic educator, but also his depth and breadth about his knowledge of astronomy is so strong that he can answer almost any question I ever ask. And so the combination of the creativity, the fantastic educator, the knowledge, he very lovingly put this show together, and he added all kinds of little Easter eggs.
Well, let's hear, because Nirvani Williams, as we mentioned, experienced this, and Nate talks a little bit about his love of Taylor with Nirvani Williams.
Okay.
I grew up with Taylor Swift, and so I've always enjoyed her music. But it is fun because songs that I didn't necessarily know I've become more familiar with and have enjoyed more. Like specifically, I Know Places was a song that I didn't even really know. I may have listened to it once, but after listening to it multiple times, it grew on me, and I really like it now, which is funny. The way that worked.
That's Nathan Wood from the Planetarium at the Springfield Museums. 1989 Taylor's version begins tomorrow and goes through May on Saturdays. And you did mention, as we're talking with Jenny Powers, who's the director of science at the museum, that Nate, just like Taylor Swift would do, has hidden some Easter eggs in this. Let's hear Nate talking a little bit about some of the Easter eggs.
A lot of the visuals, I basically listened to the song, kind of thought what I felt fit the mood of what was playing at the time, and added those in. And then I also went into Taylor Swift's life a little bit, like two cats come up at one point, stuff like that.
So there's a black heart at one point because she has a black tattoo of a heart on her foot. And so there's a bunch of other little things.
I didn't even know that. That's
Well, she doesn't talk about it as much as she used to. She talked about that more during the debut era.
You are such a Taylor nerd, Jenny Powers, and it seems like Nate is too, as well as Nirvani Williams, who took that audio at the museums after getting to experience a little bit about it. But what I think is kind of the coolest part from an astronomical standpoint is the Easter egg about December 13th, 1989. Can you tell us what people will experience tomorrow and every Saturday going through May if they come to witness this in this planetarium?
Yes. So, well, first, I hope that they're going to come early and explore the museum. You do have to pay museum admission to go to the show. So remember that Taylor is not the only thing we feature, but we'd love to have you come to that show. So they'll see about seven songs. Each song has visuals set to it. And I would describe them as kaleidoscopic, psychedelic. The images and the colors respond to the beat of the music. Mm-hmm. So that's what makes it really cool. I mean, you can play the same song 10 times. It'll look different every time. So there's a lot of options with that. So Nate picked seven that he felt really went. The Bad Blood one, honestly, is the most stunning visual one. That's about in the middle. But he picked the different visuals, put it together, and then we can also insert our own images into the show. So I don't want to give away too much, but in Out of the Woods, there's an image of a wolf. And so in Taylor's version in that video, there's a wolf. And so that relates back to the song. But then at the end of the show, we really don't want people to leave without getting at least a little bit of astronomy because it is the planetarium.
Yeah, right.
And so what we do is we set the stars on Taylor's birthday and we go through the constellations. So these are the things that Taylor was born under.
You can see what the sky looked like on the night of the actual Taylor Swift's birth in 1989.
Yeah, well, we can show almost any night in our planetarium. So if you wanted to come up and see what the stars look like the night you were born, we could do that really easily.
And at any time, you could just set it like that?
Yeah.
I think that's incredible. It's really fun. It's a really wonderful place. I got to go to the grand opening of the new projection about a year ago now. And we're speaking with Jenny Powers, who's the director of science at the Springfield Museum's Taylor Swift's 1989 Taylor's version is going to be featured Saturdays starting tomorrow through May. All right. Now we're going to talk a little bit about astronomy and a little bit about Taylor. So
okay.
The Europa Clipper. You're familiar with this mission? It's going to send a Clipper mission through the plumes coming off of Europa, a moon of Jupiter.
Oh, okay,
if
yes.
If they get even the tiniest little bit of those plumes, they may find life in it. Do you think they will? Or is that not a scientific question?
No, that's a really good science question because for a long time we wondered if the first life on Earth had come out of plumes of steam here. Do I think that they will find life? I hope so. I hope they will. But I don't want to give a guess for sure because, you know, we have learned so much about life really not existing in other places. And we've detected RNA on asteroids or meteorites that came into our atmosphere. And so RNA is that building block. The fact that it came into our atmosphere from a different place really opens up what we know about life being possible other places. So life, we know, is possible other places. It being the kind of life that we can recognize is a different story.
Mm-hmm.
I always go back to Kurt Vonnegut's Tralfamagorians, and they were like a plunger with a hand on the top, with an eye in the middle. And I don't think they're going to find those in the steam vents.
Okay. We may find microbial life.
Yes.
Taylor Swift and Travis Kelce are in the Bahamas, and she's been dropping hints that they may be engaged or that she may be pregnant. Do you believe there's any truth to those rumors?
Oh, my gosh. My son would love this. Do I believe there's truth in those rumors? I don't. About engaged, I doubt it because Taylor has been with other guys for a significant amount of time and hasn't gotten engaged to them. I think she is a woman who likes to very smartly take things slow and really get to know somebody. And so she hasn't made a lifetime commitment yet. If she's pregnant, oh, my gosh, that is a lifetime commitment right there.
Yeah.
I would love to see a Taylor baby, and I would love to hear the album that she writes for her baby.
Oh, me too.
Because, you know, her relationships are so integral in the songs that she writes. That's part of what makes her so authentic. So I'm going to say I doubt it for engaged. I hope for baby, and I hope even more for the baby album.
Aha. Jenny Powers is the director of science at Springfield Museums and is a Swiftie. There is a NASA Swift Observatory. Are you familiar with this?
No, I'm not.
it just last week suspended operations. It runs, I guess, with like a gyroscope sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
It just seemed kind of crazy that on March 15th, NASA's Neil Gehrels Swift Observatory entered into safe mode, temporarily suspending science operation due to degrading performance from one of its three gyroscopes. This, according to phys.org. So maybe you can incorporate the NASA Swift Observatory into the Swift, Taylor Swift show at the planetarium.
Most of the local astronomers I know are really focused on one thing right now, and that's the eclipse. And so you've said a couple of things. I'm like, do I know what that is? I have to think about it a little bit because I am eclipse focused. I'm going to go to totality for the first time in my life.
Where are you going?
I'm going to Buffalo and I'm going with a team of more seasoned astronomers so that they can yell what to do and I can do it. And I don't have to worry about it in the 3.5 minutes that we're going to have totality.
What do you mean yell what to do?
Well, when we go into totality, you can take your glasses off and then you can look at the sky.
But then and only in full totality.
Only in full totality. And then at some point you have to put them back on. And also, you know, I'm taking three cameras and a telescope with me. And so remembering what to do in those 3.5 minutes and be able to do that all right and remember and have this emotional experience of my first time in totality, that's a lot. And so one thing I'm really excited about, though, is I received a gift of a 360 camera, and I can make videos for the planetarium with that camera. So I'm going to set that camera up, and I'm going to try to film the entire eclipse, and then I can bring it back and put it on the planetarium dome.
Do you think Jake Gyllenhaal still has Taylor Swift's scarf?
Oh, yeah.
You do?
I mean, you think you can do better than Taylor Swift?
Last question, and since we were talking about the eclipse, does the Springfield Museums have any big eclipse plans?
Yes. So something quite weird at Springfield Museums is that almost all the astronomy staff and all the STARS Club who we partner with, they all get out of town.
Yeah. Note to anybody who wants to talk to an astronomer, don't do it that second week of April right there. Everyone will be gone.
We're busy.
Yeah.
But so two of our planetarium instructors are staying behind, and we're hoping some STARS Club members will come in and help them. We'll have a filtered telescope so you can look at it safely. We'll have some eclipse glasses. Last time in 2017, I went and experienced that eclipse at the Quad. We had about 1,000 people, and it was so fun sharing it with so many people because everybody was just filled with wonder. It's going to be 93.8% covered here in Springfield. It's not totality, but that doesn't matter because it is a magical experience, and some people only get to experience an eclipse a couple times in their entire lives. So I hope that people will come to the Quad. I hope they will enjoy that fellowship and that shared experience. For me, I feel like as we move further and further away from neighborhood traditions, we lose some of that communal experience. And the eclipse is one of those days that you can absolutely have that. Last time, a kid had made that box that they put over their head to view it. And at the end of the day, I traded him my eclipse glasses for it. We had shared both the whole time. I hope that anybody who can get to totality will. But if not, definitely be at Springfield Museums and tell my staff they're doing a great job.
That's Jenny Powers, the director of science at the Springfield Museums. We're going to have a lot of talk about the eclipse as it gets closer on this show as well. There is 1989 Taylor's version, the Planetarium Show, which begins tomorrow and will run Saturdays through May. Thank you so much for joining us. Later in the show, Live Music Friday with our first in-studio live hip-hop, Tem Blessed, who's playing the Drake in Amherst tonight, will join us. Up next, two Mediterranean wines enter the Wine Thunderdome at Table and Vine in West Springfield. You're listening to The Fabulous 413 on 88.5 NEPM. We're back in the Wine Thunderdome at Table and Vine in West Springfield with Table and Vine ambassador Michael Quinlan. Thanks for having us, Michael Quinlan.
Oh, so great to have you as always.
Yeah.
So fun.
And what are we drinking? And this two wines enter, one wine leaves Thunderdome today.
So I'm on a whole like Mediterranean exploration right now. What I'm working on is a white wine piece for the spring, but I've been reading like all of this stuff and drinking all these wines from the Mediterranean and basically from Gibraltar or on the Spanish side.
Where I might end up going in May.
Nice. All the way down to the toe of the boot. It's about a 2,000 mile coastal journey, right? And there's so many wine regions that are impacted by the power of the warmth of the water and the sunshine there, mm-hmm. right? So there's this great line from Kermit Lynch to describe wines from Corsica, but I really feel like it applies to this whole sort of, let's call it a crescent.
It's why are there so many wines from Corsica?
Not that Kermit. Well, it is Kermit Lynch.
Kermit and David Kermit. Lynch. Here we go. We've got another Muppets Twin Peaks mashup.
Diane, this Agent Cookie reporting. Me in town called Twin Peaks. Darn fine town.
But so on this 2,000-mile journey, there's like a ton of wines. And so Kermit says about wines from Corsica, these are wines impacted by sun, stone, sea, and wind. And then if you think about those four things, they do affect everything in that whole 2,000-mile stretch. So
Kermit Lynch, in all seriousness, is like, I think of him as like a Berry Gordy, somebody who runs an awesome record label that you love. And when you see his name on a thing, you're like, oh, I understand what Berry Gordy means. And I like that kind of music. Do you love me?
I can feel it too. absolutely.
You see Kermit Lynch on the back of a label, it's the same thing, where you're like, oh, I respect his palate, his taste, and what he's into.
Oh, that is terrible. That's the most appalling, disgusting, revolting thing I've ever seen.
No question about it, right? I mean, just one of the top flight importers, and having been doing it for so long, right? I mean, it just, the impact of Kermit Lynch on our industry, for imported wines especially, is just unparalleled.
Mm-hmm. So what are the wines we're going to try?
We have one wine from Minervois, right? So you're in the Languedoc, and one wine from the island of Sardinia. But what's interesting about the red wines from the whole crescent here is it's a lot of the same varieties, and we commonly refer to them as Rhone varieties, but they're really Mediterranean varieties because they're not just grown in the Rhone Valley, but they're called different names everywhere. It's amazing, right? Carignan is Carignan in France. It's Carignano on Sardinia. It's Masuelo in Spain. And, you know, Grenache is Grenache. It's Garnacha. And it's Cananao, right? So there's all these different names for these things, but it's the same grapes that grow throughout this region, which is somewhat logical.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start with the Maziac, Sentinel de Maziac from Minervois. This is a second wine of this winery. They make a great Minervois, and then they make this wine as a more drinkable version, basically.
Yeah, and probably a lot more affordable.
Much more affordable. It's about half the price, right? I mean, so it really works for, you know, wine that you can afford to drink all the time.
Cherries and blood.
Cherries and blood.
Yeah, lots of minerality.
Yeah, so this is Syrah, 75% Syrah, 25% Carignan. You know, what I love about this winery in the description, so again, we were talking about the great importer, Kermit Lynch. This is imported by Neil Rosenthal, another, like, gold standard importer. Mm-hmm. And so, again, it's one of those things, when you see Neil Rosenthal's name on the back of the label, you can pretty much trust the wine.
Well, that stands right up. I think just like the bait and switch of it being French, and he's like, oh yeah, it's gonna smell like blood, but it's gonna be pretty soft. Nope.
Yeah, that Mediterranean influence on French wine gives it a lot of that more leathery, you know, thing that you might get from what you might think of as an Italian or a Spanish wine.
Yeah, and also I think the acidity of Carignan, right, is like, it makes your mouth water from the moment you feel the wine until now. I swallowed it a moment ago, still, my mouth is still watering, right? Mm-hmm. It's just amazing.
This has got a lot of like tar, tobacco stuff in there too. It's really like a chewy wine, I would like to say.
When you look at the color, it's purple. Yeah. Right? I mean, it's still young. It's 2021. Both wines are 2021, but it's like purple in color. You don't necessarily anticipate some of those like earthy, dark sort of flavors, but man, oh man.
Yeah.
Syrah.
Right? I love
Syrah.
It. Syrah. Yeah, yeah. A little bit peppery, which is what my usual thing is with Syrah, but not as much as I might have expected. Probably because of the other things it's blended with, but.
Big limestone here too. Mm-hmm. You just feel
it. It is stony.
Yeah.
Going back to the Lynch quote.
You remind me today of a small Mexican chihuahua.
Right, thinking about like the sun's impact is obvious here, right? There's beautiful fruit to this wine, right? There's ripeness, there's alcohol, which all comes from the sun. The stone is on full display. The sort of salty, acidic character is there from the sea. And the wind, right, it's not a clunky wine at all. It's totally clean, right? Because the wind just keeps any sort of like mold or rot or anything heavy setting in there. Mm-hmm. It's just wonderful, wonderful wine.
I love that as a Kermit Lynch way to think of Mediterranean wines.
Yeah.
All right, wine number one again. Michael Quinlan here at Table and Vine in West Springfield.
Sentinel de Maziac, Minervois 2021.
Oh,
this is a bad bottle. This
yes!
Sort.
I knew it! I knew it right away! Woo! It was a test for myself to be like, I think this bottle is corked, but I want to see what Michael Quinlan says. Oh, I am a real wine snob.
Oh, look at you.
The dead giveaway?
The wet newspaper. Yeah, the damp thing.
I've never seen Michael Quinlan run so fast.
Oh, have you seen my kids run?
I love smelling corked bottles of wine, though, because I love to know and recognize it.
Weirdest fetish I've ever heard.
Well, don't, then you know, all of my time doing this up until now has led to this moment where I could say, I'm pretty sure this bottle is corked. And there we go.
Nice coche.
Yay.
Yeah, wet newspaper right away.
Dead, like dead weed.
Bleach.
Yeah.
I get less bleach.
I get it as bleach too now that you say that. Let's see. Take two. Boop.
That's fun.
I think it is fun to like, and then you can, you know, you'll be at your friend's house and be like, this wine is corked. I don't know what you're talking about. Well, it smells like what newspaper. It's all about showing off. It's the only reason I drink wine in the first place.
I was at a wedding one time and we were ordering glasses of wine. Now I'm breathing heavy.
See, I told you, we're running fast.
Bartender's like, so we smell the wine. We're like, oh, this is corked. The bartender's like, I know it's corked. I just took the cork out.
Oh, no.
Drinking wine at a wedding was your first mistake.
It depends on the wedding.
If we go to Yankee Sippa's wedding, that'll be different. Okay, here we go. No, none of that cork taint, which is just
so
fun
different.
To say.
Oh, goodness.
Well, like, now I'm sort of like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, much better. Yeah.
Much better.
A lot of the same cherry type notes that I was getting in the first one.
So this is Argiolas Costera, which is Cananao de Sardegna. Cananao is Grenache. What's really neat about this wine is that it's 90% Cananao. The other 10% or 5% of Bovale Sardo, which you know.
He's the mayor of Springfield.
He's never coming on the show.
He's never coming
now.
On the show.
Never.
He
never.
Hasn't yet, and I think that's sealed.
No,
that's sealed.
He was on once. He was on once.
Monte, I want to thank you for what you do on your walk to raise awareness of hunger and help out homelessness and all the food.
Bovale Sardo, which you Rioja fans know as Graciano, which is just...
Great boxer.
Great boxer. And then also 5% Carignano.
Same grape as
Carignan,
yeah, yeah.
Which there was 25% in the first wine. Mm-hmm.
So there's got to be similarities.
So the relativity here is not about the grape varieties exactly. It's just about the fact that the Mediterranean can be over here and over here. The wines can be similar but different. This is a little more money than the other one. You're on the north side of the Hamilton and a half.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sardinia is one of those blue zones too, right? Where they like,
and
specifically about Cananao as a grape, like when the industry puts forward an article about how good wine is for you, which probably is verifiably scientifically false, this is like the kind of wine exactly that they're trying to look at.
So Argiolas is kind of the gold standard winery from Sardinia, right? This is a winery we've done business with as long as I've worked at Table and Vine, which is 28 years this week. Woohoo! And, but there's another brand called Sella and Mosca that was featured on Dr. Oz as a Blue Zone thing, yeah. And the sales just went like crazy before Dr. Oz did.
I thought I'd do some grocery shopping. I'm at Wegner's, and my wife wants some vegetables for crudité.
This is such a role reversal because, I mean, like, I'm basic, so, like, you give me French, and I'm like, okay, it's going to be soft, and you give me Italian, I mean, it's Sardinia, so not exactly the same, but, like, Italian, and I'm like, that's going to stand up, and it's exactly the opposite. This is so pliable.
Yeah, it's much more incorporated. Like, the tannins feel a lot smoother, mm-hmm. velvety.
They come a little bit at the end, but they smooth right out.
The other big difference here, the soil type's the same, right? The influence of the sea is very similar. The wind thing for these two wines, right? This is a huge difference maker. Minervois gets the cold wind coming from the north of France. The Mistral comes through the Rhone and Provence, cools everything off there. This is on the bottom part of Sardinia. It gets a hot wind coming from the Sahara.
Wow, that's interesting.
So like
that's
that
really
softness
cool.
to it just makes like so much sense when you think about warm air, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, and all the years of drinking wine, I haven't really thought that much about how much of an influence wind is. So that's really interesting.
Yeah, and wind leads to concentration. It always leads to cleanliness, of course. So it's just amazing. Such a great.
That's why I wind bathe.
Oh, God.
The people of Turner's Falls do not appreciate it, but I'm so clean.
She's like the wind.
This one has a little more molasses than, say, the tobacco or tar of the first one, too. So there's a touch of type of sweetness.
Thank you for putting a name to it. It's like pomegranate molasses.
Oh, yeah. There we go.
Oh,
so nice.
Back to the fact that one of them was corked. As a person that works at Table and Vine, if you're at home and you smell wet newspaper in your wine that you bought at Table and Vine or elsewhere, will you take that back?
Absolutely. Put the cork back in the bottle, bring it back to us. You know, people will bring empty bottles back and say this was no good, so we dumped it. And we always kind of laugh about it. And if somebody brings in a bottle that has like 2 ounces left in the bottle, we're like, oh, it was so bad you couldn't finish it. Like, we kind of chuckle about that stuff.
Right.
But ultimately, we want our customers to be happy with what they buy here, so we're happy to take things back if you're not satisfied.
Note
to self, drink the whole bottle and bring it back and say, I didn't like it.
Don't
do that, listener.
My last Thunderdome.
I'm coming back for Thunderdome. I'll come alone. I didn't say any of that. I want to learn more.
All right.
So Graciano is this really cool grape that has like a lot of like, has a longevity about it, right? Really lends itself to ageability in wines and structures them. But it also has this really neat cola thing that I think is just whispering in this wine a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
Again, it's only 5%. Bovale Sardo, your honor.
You'll never unhear it.
So I'm glad to be here to say a couple of words and I'm off to a 6 o'clock.
Okay, it's time to vote. Michael Quinlan?
I really love both of these wines and they're wines that I drink at home. A decent amount because I think they're both tremendous value, but it's hard not to vote for the Argiolas Costera Cananao de Sardegna.
I second that emotion. I thought for sure at the beginning in the first go-round that I was going to go for the Minervois, and I really love how austere it is, but there is a softness to the Cananao, and it has, I think, a lot of the things that the Languedoc one has, but it also wants a little bit of food. It's got that the tannin, and while I don't generally want to vote for a wine based on whether it needs food or not, There's something about it that hits all the right points for me with the Canonite.
That was literally the first thing that I thought when drinking the Minervois. I was like, oh, this wants food. Whereas, like, the Argiolas, I think, is just, like, it's pliable, and it's got a lot of these, this is going to sound so weird, it's got these neat brown flavor notes, like, yeah, going through it that so I think right. are, so, like, not quite jus, but, like dark, like, Maillard reaction-y tasting things that I really quite like. So, yeah, we'll make it a threesome.
There we go. The green zone Cannonau.
Only blue zone.
Blue zone Cannonau. Where's the green zone? I don't know. That was last weekend, St. Patrick's Day.
So I just want to say, the last time we tasted together, you picked the more austere wine, and we had all these jokes about your upbringing and how you always pick the wines that are more brutal. But today, it's a little different story.
Yeah. You've been feeling a little soft now that spring is around. Softening up.
Now that the cold's not making you hard and unfeeling.
Yeah. How else am I supposed to manage to get through the winter? Toughen up. Rub some dirt on it.
Gird your loins.
Loins sufficiently girded.
We don't need another Pinot.
Khalees isn't here to tell me not to play her version of this. There you go. Up next, it's Live Music Friday, and we'll hear rapper, podcaster, graphic novelist Tem Bless, who's playing the Drake in Amherst tonight. You're listening to The Fabulous 413 on 88.5 NEPM.
The Fabulous 413 podcast is funded by Northeast Solar, helping customers make the switch to solar for savings, energy security, and tax incentives. Learn more at northeast-solar.com.
Ugh. Who's knocking at your door? He's the dopest MC in town.
Welcome back to the Fabulous 413. I'm Monty Belmonte, and I am joined in the studio by Tem Blest, a socially conscious hip-hop artist that's been making relevant music with a message for over a decade. Born in Guinea-Bissau, West Africa, to Cape Verdean parents, his music and message is about social justice and sustainability and is designed to inspire the audience toward positive change and global responsibility. He's a graduate of UMass Amherst, and his work to empower youth, designed to inspire the audience toward positive change and global responsibility. His music and message are about social justice and sustainability, and Tem has shared the stage with national acts like Common, KRS-One, Ludacris, and Paul Stuckey from Peter, Paul, and Mary?
Yes.
One of these things is not like the other. Tem Blest is part of the Blest Energy Band. Tem recently released an Afrofuturistic graphic novel titled Planeta Blue, Rise of a Goo, published by Dark Horse Comics, which is a legendary comic publisher. You may remember him from being on the show when that came out. We got a lot of feedback after that of people saying, I want to get that graphic novel for my kid for the holidays. And it's pretty great. The graphic novel is also designed to encourage and inspire young adults to dream big and work hard towards saving humanity through compassion, sacrifice, determination, and love. Tem Blest, among the first ever performers inside the Drake while it was in construction mode, right?
Yeah.
I saw that video on their website, and you will return there tonight now that it is fully operational. Let's hear something. The first Live Music Friday hip hop performer live in the studio, Tem Blest.
Let's go. Yeah. Fabulous 413. This goes out to all the people, real Americans, young Americans. Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. We the Americans we've been waiting for. We don't want more war. We want peace, love, and universal law. Universal health care and corporate welfare. Reparations for those enslaved, hell yeah. No fracking nowhere. Strength of the black bear. First Nation heritage. Confederate flag acts here. Klan gets unmasked here. Trump soupe snatch here. Make America hate again. That's so last year. Of course, all lives matter. Why black lives matter less? Put cameras on all your vests so we can watch you and all the rest. Do the right thing and they won't be massive protests. We vote yes. Free state college, fossil fuels abolished. Stop deceiving the people, teach them real knowledge, like how to gain wealth and maintain health. Stop working for someone else and work for ourselves, like yeah.
Americans we've been waiting for.
That's right, where the leaders at. Nadia Alves.
We vote, yeah.
For the
telling me I ain't got a right to be free. I ain't got a right to be happy, a right to be me. I ain't got a right to choose if and when I have a family, a right to marry, a right to equal salary. And what you spraying in our skies, though? I see those planes flying high, hygiene engineering so we die slow. Mass incarcerating the people, the new Jim Crow. We active, not cynical, saying no to GMO. We say yes to social justice. A social unrest will take over the Oval Office. We want to be prosperous, not just the 1%, but the populace. Hack your banks, where's Anonymous? We honor this commitment to Mother Earth. Stand with Standing Rock until I'm laying in the dirt. We don't discriminate against any religion, whether Muslim or Christian, Buddhism or Hinduism. Listen, yeah, come on. Blessed Energy's in the studio. Yeah, Blessed Energy. Fabulous 413, let's go, come on. Yeah. Shout out to DJ Angeli on the cuts, Nadia on the vocals. Yeah.
The Americans we've been waiting for.
That's right. Yeah. Go. We at the Drake tonight. Yeah.
Yes to social justice.
That's right, for everybody. It's a unity movement, y'all. It's a one love movement, y'all. Yeah.
We vote yet.
Guy comes into my studio wearing a Wu-Tang shirt, first of all, and then proceeds to remix David Bowie, who's one of my favorite artists of all time. That person is Tim Blessed, who is here for Live Music Friday. He's going to be at the Drake tonight, not far from your alma mater, right?
Yeah, UMass Amherst. UMass Amherst. And I got the whole crew with me. You know, I got Zeke on the drums. I got DJ Sigma all the way from St. Martin. Nadia, which you heard on the track, beautiful voice. She's going to be on there. And See the Light, who's my partner in rhyming, partner in life, will be there too. And we got a lot of great artists like Young Sobe's going to be in there, Big Sobe, I should say, Lil South, and also Ahmed. So we got a crew. And it's for the community, always.
That's amazing. And it's happening tonight at the Drake in Amherst. Let's take a little break. We'll come back and we'll hear more live music this Live Music Friday from Tim Blessed. You're listening to the Fabulous 413 on 88.5 NEPM.
Great. Time to change, so much pain.
Welcome back to the Fabulous 413. I'm Monty Belmonte, and it's Live Music Friday. And playing live at the Drake in Amherst tonight is Tim Blessed, who is not only a rapper, not only a podcaster, but is a graphic novelist. And we had him on the show back around the holidays talking about Planeta Blue, Rise of a Goo, which is amazing. We had the illustrator on as well.
Yeah, Mike.
A really cool story about kids that end up having these powers to save humanity from the destruction that we've caused it. How has that book been doing, and what's the future of that dark horse comic, Planeta Blue?
Oh, man, it's been a great journey. The book's been doing great. We just had a meeting with our editor who wants, they want a book two. So Dark Horse wants a book two. And so we're working on it. So book two's on the way. I've been writing on it, in the middle of writing all kinds of other stuff. So things are good. Getting great feedback from young people is good when, you know, just the other day I ran into some young people at the Science Museum. I was doing something with Cooler Communities at Springfield Science Museum. And one of the kids who had gone into their classroom said, I got your book. And I was like, really? What do you think? Because I generally want to know. And she was like, it's amazing. And I was like, yes. You know what I mean? So that feels always good, because you're trying to, you know, make these stories for the youth. It's a young adult graphic novel. And to hear that it's connecting with them, that obviously makes you feel really good.
That's so good. Yeah, and your music is overwhelmingly positive. And that's the message. That's what you're going for, right?
We need that. You know, there's an imbalance, I feel. You know, we all like, you know, just to party, have a good time. But as we know, especially in hip-hop genre, rock and roll too, and other genres, sometimes the focus is, in my opinion, not always on the right stuff, right? And for me, I came up in the time of the golden age of hip-hop. So for me, like KRS-One, right? Rock Kim, you know, Tribe Called Quest, De La Soul. Those are the people that I was looking up to and wanted to be like, because their music was about something and they were dropping knowledge in the rhymes that were inspiring and would get you not only moving but also thinking, which I think is important, especially as a poet. It's very important.
Yeah. How are people reacting, Temblest, when you sing like that last song that you did? Some people might be like, I don't agree with everything there politically speaking. How does the music bridge the divide between those political issues?
I think it's like comedy, you know what I mean? Like sometimes you say something that people are going to like or dislike, but it's always about the conversation, right? I think what's difficult now is a lot of people just shutting down the conversation or the debate. And that's dangerous. You know, I'm from Cape Verde, originally West Africa. And when I went to Guinea-Bissau, where I was born, I saw how there was, at least at that time, a few years back, such animosity to the other side, right? The opposition, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, man, that's so different than how it was in the States. However, now the United States is like that, where people are like, you know, ready for, unfortunately, a potential civil war because they don't like what you're saying.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And at the end of the day, it's like, we don't want that. We don't want more war. Like, as the song said, we want peace. We want love. We want justice. It's what everybody wants, you know, at least most of the people, right? And so what's wrong with our governments? And so in the spirit of Public Enemy and, you know, Black Star and others, right, that's the lineage that Blessed Energy, my band, my crew, and Temblest always got to show up with.
Well, let's hear one more from Temblest, who is playing at the Drake in Amherst tonight.
Yeah. Temblest, yeah. Dark Brass, yeah. Blessed Energy, Fabulous 413, let's go, yo. Focus like a laser beam. I made the A-team, more than just a daydream. My life is amazing. What are you waiting for? We could abolish war, liberate and be the cure. Be the wealth, feed the poor. Sipping on that watermelon. I keep rebelling, I keep on yelling. Ceasefire, free Palestine, free your mind. We gon' ride a modern day apartheid. Try to hide your genocide, that's suicide. Stay alive, stay safe, stay wise. I got two wives, see the light in this mic. It's kinda hard to do work at night. My PS5 invites me to Fortnite. The girls like the gold gun, the mythical. I'm spiritual, life is a miracle. Rum pum pum pum, you better run. You better build a better world. Make a mill, a better girl. Or better yet, make a billy and get a queen. We all kings, we gon' win. Put that on everything. All of my kin, this the medicine from the veteran. Temblest, focus like a laser beam. I made the A-team, more than just a daydream. My life is amazing. What are you waiting for? We could abolish war, liberate and be the cure. Be the wealth, feed the poor. Focus like a laser beam. I made the A-team, more than just a daydream. My life is amazing. What are you waiting for? We could abolish war, liberate and be the cure. Be the wealth, feed the poor. Life as a human being, seeing what I am seeing. I'm not believing, I feel like leaving. I feel like screaming, I start to breathing. This my season, I'm emceeing. Hands up to the ceiling, this beat is hitting. I wrote the written, adding notes like mathematician. I got the vision, manifest like a magician. I'm on a mission, girl, to get in your kitten. Like I just got out of prison, hopping up my ebony AMG, gracefully escaping slavery. Now aura is my legacy, making bread so steadily, like I'm working at the bakery. Focus like a laser beam. I made the A-team, more than just a daydream. My life is amazing. What are you waiting for? We could abolish war, liberate and be the cure. Be the wealth, feed the poor. Focus like a laser beam. I made the A-team, more than just a daydream. My life is amazing. What are you waiting for? We could abolish war, liberate and be the cure. Be the wealth, feed the poor. Yeah. Feed the poor. Uh-huh. Yeah. Be the cure.
Yes, indeed.
Tem Blessed, live in the studio.
Lick shot.
Live Music Friday, our first hip hop live music. Brand new. That was a radio debut. First time anybody's ever heard it.
Dropped today.
Where do people find that?
You can find it at my website, temblessed.com, and all the proceeds, 100%, go to help the people of Gaza. That's what, if you download that beat and that song, I should say, all the proceeds, 100%, is going to go to the people of Gaza. So check it out, temblessed.com. I'm going to be doing that live tonight, and we're shooting part of the video.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So you can be a part of Temblessed video at the Drake in Amherst tonight. Thank you so much for coming by, Tem. This is going to go full circle now because Tem was just at the Springfield Museums, and we had the Taylor Swift thing that's happening on Saturday at the Springfield Museums, and then Kendrick is part of the song from the Taylor's version. And thank you for coming by and giving us your hip-hop. And thanks to the Springfield Museums for what they're doing, too. Next week on the Fabulous 413, we'll hear from the Mass Farm to School panel with Irene Cheyenne Lee, who's a food justice advocate. We'll also hear from the two other panelists, including East Hampton's own Ollie Peralta, a 17-year-old climate activist from East Hampton. We'll talk about EV cars and more. It's Monty. See you Monday on the Fabulous 413.